Thank you. I understand I have about like 45 minutes to talk and ask questions. I'll try to answer if it's okay to ask questions while I'm talking. I may just say, wait till I get to this next page. But here we go. Part of the focus of what I want to talk about today is the interaction of cultural artifacts with cognition. So I think cultural artifacts both reflect what people are thinking and affect what people are thinking. And I think Mirta kind of oversold the complex systems part of what we're doing. We're trying to get there, and I have some hints at the end, and we have a grant that runs a couple more years. So the work I'm going to talk about today involves a partnership of three entities: Northwestern University, the American Indian Center of Chicago, and the Menominee Nation in Wisconsin. If you're a football fan, the Menominee Nation is up close to Green Bay. This is Megan Bang, the co-principal investigator. I've worked with her for probably the last 20 years. And as Mirta said, we're trying to do community and culturally based research. So the American Indian Center is surrounded by a medicinal garden that's also used in some teaching. This is Karen Washnawatak, who's our Menominee co-PI. When I first started doing this work, I was actually at Michigan when John Holland was there. I told the colleague I was going to do some work on culture, and he just kind of, not quite a sneer, he just said, "I only want to study what's universal." And I don't know how he knew what was universal. I think of culture as more like a verb than a noun, more
than just a simple set of beliefs. I'll say more about that later. And today I'm going to focus on framework theories or epistemological orientation. The simple way of thinking about this is different ways of looking at the world. I'll try to show you some converging evidence for some of these cultural differences. So a couple disclaimers. I think last time I looked, there were 573 federally recognized tribes. The American Indian Center has more than 100 different tribal nations represented. So anything I say about Native Americans, you should say to yourself, maybe Plains Indians, but probably just the Menominee Nation and you could even think that Chicago has a lot of Menominees at the American Indian Center, so you could just think it might be just that. And I think of culture as creating habitats where certain kinds of ideas can catch on and be supported versus others. So let me tell you a little bit about the Menominee Nation. Menominee means, they didn't name themselves this. This is, other tribes gave them the name Menominee. It means the wild rice people. They're the oldest continuous residents of Wisconsin. They live on their current land is a subset of the lands that they had before, so they're not a tribe that's been displaced from, say, the East Coast. They have like 234,000 acres now. At one point, people estimate there were like 9 million acres. And there are about 5,000 people living on the res. This is a satellite image. The Menominee are known for their sustainable forestry practices. This delineates right here the Menominee tribe. tribal lands, and you can see that the vegetation is strikingly different from the surrounding land. And to me, it's a little bit surprising, because if you go to the north, you get to the Nicolet National Forest, and it looks to me like the Menominee Forest is healthier than the Nicolet Forest. This is just a little context about the Menominee tribe. This is a picture of around the time of the sturgeon ceremony in the spring, where sturgeon come up from Lake Winnebago to spawn in the rivers close by. They would spawn on the res if it weren't for a couple dams that were built outside the reservation. One of the reasons I, out of just kind of out of the blue, decided I might be able to work with this group is there's a college there. They have no psychologist there, but they had an ecologist, and I met with her early on. For a lot of the comparison group, comparison studies, we're dealing with a county that's just south of the Menominee Reservation. If anyone's from the Midwest and you know Door County, that's very touristy, a lot of art, a lot of people. When you go west from Green Bay, it's like going back to the 1950s. It's hunting, fishing, not so much art, and not necessarily in that order. The big five are God, hunting, fishing, family, and the Packers. And actually, the head of the Menominee I'm trying to forget. I've lost this title, but the head of the Cultural Preservation Committee has a Green Bay Packer screensaver on his computer. So there's a picture of downtown Shawano. It's the county capital. There are about 7,000 people that live in the area. This is what a lot of the surrounding countryside looks like. It's pretty rural. So in our time today, I'm going to talk, for sure I'll get through the first topic, psychological distance from nature, and I hope I'll get into some of the data on ecological versus taxonomic thinking. And if there's time, I want to talk about cultural differences in perspective taking, attention to context, and the role of humans in nature. So the first study we did was just a series of interviews.
How much interaction is there between the two? How much
between the Shawano, the Shawano County and Menominee County? There's a modest amount of interaction. It's not necessarily an unbiased sample. So the least biased sample would be Menominees taking their cars to get repaired off the reservation. For a different talk, I would talk about the conflict between the European American model of hunting and fishing and Menominee model of hunting and fishing. I'll just say briefly, one sentence answer. The conflict over these issues is systematically related to the number of Menominees you know, for example. So the more contact, the less the stereotypes. Like I said, I really could give a separate talk on this. So here's the first. You wouldn't even call this a study if you're a self-respecting cognitive psychologist. We did these interviews where we asked parents and grandparents, what do you want your kids to learn about the natural world? What do you want your kids or grandkids to learn about the biological world? And we adopted Stephen Kellert's coding system for different kinds of worldviews that might be revealed. So you could be very utilitarian, et cetera, et cetera. But what became very clear in the data is that a key variable that we needed to pay attention to is subjective proximity to nature. So we would call something distant utilitarian if a use was described in the abstract, versus personal utilitarian, where someone says, we do this with this. And then there's abstract liking. Someone might say, I want my children to enjoy nature. The results, in part, are what you might expect. I mean, everyone says they want their kids to be able to recognize poison ivy. So that's pretty obvious. But for purposes of today, I'm going to focus on distant versus more proximal orientations. And one result is the rural European American sample is very likely to give a distant orientation. The Menominee sample, it says Native American because this is done both with Menominees and with Chicago area parents and grandparents. And they didn't differ from each other. And let me rush through another study first and then I'll give you the punchline of this. We also ask about outdoor practices that people engage in. We had a list of, I think it was like 37 outdoor practices, and we asked people whether they did them and how often. So it could be just sitting outside, mowing the lawn, playing basketball outside, etc. And again, our samples were rural Menominee, rural European American, and urban Native American. And in this case, we asked both children and adults. I personally do not think there's a big distinction between nature being foregrounded versus background. It depends on the particular model you have. But at least there was a consensus across. We had four Native and four European American adults rate these different kinds of practices as foregrounding or backgrounding nature. So they would probably say playing basketball on a court outside is backgrounding nature. Going for a walk in the woods would be a no-brainer foregrounding nature. There was a strong overall consensus. And basically, for both children and adults, our Native sample is more likely to engage in practices in which nature is foregrounded and less likely to engage in practices in which nature is backgrounded. To me, these two quotes tell it all. So it's very common for European American adults to say, I want my kids to respect nature and know that they have a responsibility to take care of it. None of them said, I want my children to understand that they're a part of nature. That was fairly common with our Native American sample. Another source of data we came up with is using Google Images. Mirta, you might appreciate this. So we entered ecosystem. And here's a representative sample of what you might see. If you've got your computer here now, you can do this experiment yourself. We looked at the first 500 images, and what we were looking at is what percentage of these images have humans in them? The answer is, anyone want to guess?
Very few.
2%. And of that 2%, half the human images had them explicitly outside the system looking in. So I take this as evidence that what's being conveyed implicitly is that humans aren't a part of ecosystems. We've also done analyses of children's storybooks, where we have about 40 to 50 books that are authored and illustrated by Native Americans versus not. I think the site is still available. We got these books from oyate.com, and we compared them with books by authored and illustrated by non-natives, and those we got from Amazon.com, popular books. We avoided holiday books, and we wanted books that had at least one animal in them somewhere. Okay, so here's a typical non-native book with an animal in it, at least one animal. Very good, very good. And you could see that it is placing this animal in a human context. Here's an example of a native book. And then we coded for each of these books, we applied different, probably easiest just to tell you the results. So we had people rate, is there at least one up close and personal image in the book? For native books, they were much more likely to be up close and personal, 84% versus 31%. They were also much more likely to use perspective-taking devices like over-the-shoulder views that invite you to take the perspective of the actor. And the actor was very often an animal. I don't know if there were some Canadian authors.
Well, American, North American, I guess.
Yes, and one of the people in our lab was from the Czech Republic, and he was saying, "Well, children's books are very different in the Czech Republic in terms of what they illustrate." So, we don't necessarily know outside of U.S. and Canada, what we would find. And to me, it's one of the more striking results is that non-native books were very often had illustrations that had no context. You know, it was just the actors themselves. So far, we have like three or four converging measures on a difference in psychological distance from nature, from worldviews, foregrounded versus backgrounded practices, storybooks, and Google Images. One reason why this might matter is that if you think of humans as separate from nature, then you're liable to think humans can affect nature, but nature doesn't affect humans because you're kind of outside the system. There's actually some, I don't think there'll be time to get into this, but there's some very nice work by Peter White who's looked at causal models where you have different factors like rainfall, population changes, income changes. And his participants are Oxford University undergrads. And basically, he finds that the models, the consensual models, have simple linear relationships, and they are hugely asymmetrical. So humans are strongly agents and not at all patients. So they're, that fits with the model of humans as being outside the system. Okay, so I, much as I love this distant summary, I really think it's problematic. Just being close versus far is only a tiny part of the story. So in the children's books, the native children's books were also more likely to have a panoramic perspective than the non-native books. There's also a lot of developmental evidence suggesting that young children often conceive of humans as the prototype. So there are studies done where if you attribute a property to humans and ask whether, say, dogs have it, kids are quite likely to say yes. But if you attribute that same property to dogs and ask them if humans have it, they're very likely to say no. Susan Carey's argued that this is just a universal tendency for kids to initially start out with a biology that's very human-centered. I don't think that's quite right. And again, simple causal associations versus reciprocal relations can be quite distinct, and distance doesn't really get at that. Okay, so now I'm getting closer to talking about some real, almost experiments. So if your background is in anthropology, you probably know there's work suggesting there are universal principles of categorization where you ask people either to sort kinds into categories, and then you look at distance and you correlate that distance with taxonomic distance. And often these correlations are quite high, on the order of 0.7. But a lot of properties are correlated, so it can be very misleading to take the strong correlation as evidence of universal organization. So I'm going to tell you about some studies we did with Menominee and European American fishing experts. For the sample I'm going to tell you about, sample size is usually around 15 to 20. The average age of our participants is 45. Average years fishing, it's 40. Up there, you start out ice fishing as your first experience. And we were looking for people that were real experts. And that was based on peer nominations, but we also did a feature listening task. And you have a question?
Those averages were the same for both samples, the nominee and the European American?
Yes. within a year or two. The samples are similar in lots of ways. They fish all kinds of habitats, rivers, streams, and lakes. They target similar species. There may be some slight differences there. Menominees say they focus on, they fish to put protein on the table. European Americans, they eat the fish they catch sometimes. And there are some preferred fish, but they do a lot of catch and release. If any of you are familiar with what a muskie is, it's like a barracuda-sized freshwater fish. Well, if you belong to the muskie club and you kill a muskie, you get kicked out of the club. And European Americans are more likely to be into fishing contests. I interviewed one guy who had just won $25,000 in a fishing contest. He was going to go buy a bigger motor for his boat so that the next fishing contest he could get to the ideal sites sooner. So the first study we did, we took 44 local species of fish, And we asked the participants to sort them into groups in a way that made sense to them. European Americans either tended to sort taxonomically or in terms of goals. So taxonomically would be, oh, these are the bass family fish. These are sunfish and bluegills. These are minnows. These are walleyes and sauger. They're like first cousins of each other. Or in terms of goals. So they would say, this group is the large, prestigious game fish. These are the fish that it's good for kids to catch. That's like sunfish and bluegills, panfish. These are the fish we use to catch these other fish. And these are garbage fish. Menominee experts were more likely to sort ecologically, not all of them by any means, about actually 40% of our sample would explicitly sort ecologically, and by that I mean these are the fish you'll find in fast-moving streams. These are the fish you'll find in stagnant ponds. These are the fish you'll find in lakes, etc. But it was a striking difference. The second study we did, we took 21 of these species of fish, the ones that people were most familiar with, and we asked for each possible pair whether the first affect the second or the second affect the first. So it might be, does the walleye affect the northern or the northern affect the walleye? This interview was done in about an hour, so it was probably pretty fast pace. Given that these guys had 40 years of expertise, there's no particular reason to expect that there would be cultural differences on this task. But there were actually very large differences, yeah.
So across the different species represented, I'm assuming that some of them don't even co-occur? Or do they?
Yes.
Not? Okay.
Yes. That'll be important in just a second.
Okay.
So, Menominee experts saw more positive relations, more reciprocal relations. So, yes, northern will affect the walleye, and the walleye will affect the northern. Many of the relations that Menominees mentioned involve reciprocal eating of spawn, fry, and small fish. In other words, they're answering throughout the developmental life cycle of these species of fish. One measure we looked at for agreement across samples, we found for about 84% of the nominated relationships, both Menominee and European American experts said these relations were present. Only 1% of the time did the European Americans nominate a relationship that the Menominees didn't, and 14% of the time Menominees saw a relation that the European Americans didn't. The 1%, I think, reflects overgeneralizations. Well, I'll give you one example. So one pair was river shiner and largemouth bass. If you're a Menominee, you would just say, not in the same water. And if you're European American, you tended to say a largemouth bass will eat a river shiner, which is true if you go out fishing with a river shiner in the lake. But basically, in this part of Wisconsin, largemouth bass are found in lakes. River shiners, guess what, are found in rivers. So I found these results really puzzling because these experts were really really expert. Now, one thing a cognitive psychologist might not do, but I sort of learned to do by hanging out with anthropologists, is we would spend time with our participants. We'd maybe go have a beer with them, maybe go fishing with them, or just chat. I'll give you one example of where the European Americans did not see a reciprocal relation. So I mentioned the muskie before, kind of barracuda-like. They can get to be pretty big, like 60, 70 pounds. There's a smaller counterpart called the northern, same body shape, maybe 20 to 30 pounds. So they're the smaller counterpart. If you're European American, you said on this pair, well, a big muskie will eat a small northern. That was the end of the story. If you were Menominee, you would say a big muskie will eat a small northern, and northern fry hatch out in the spring about 2 weeks before muskie fry. So northern fry will eat muskie fry. Well, in this fast test, no European American expert mentioned that. But informally, I'd heard at least two or three times European American guys tell me about this hatching out in the spring. We started to think it was that if the speed of the task is constrained by how your knowledge is organized, then if you slow down the task, then maybe you'll start to see greater access to this. So we did one study where we explicitly asked for ecological sorting. The groups are very similar. There are no differences. So we asked them to sort by where you find the fish. And then one of the few times in my life I've made a prediction in advance that was supported by the data. It turns out that when you slow down the task from asking about 420 relations in an hour to asking about 70 relations in an hour, the cultural differences completely disappear, and the way they disappear is the European Americans start answering in terms of the entire life cycle of fish and the relationships. So that suggests that the way their knowledge is organized is somewhat different, and knowledge organization probably is better revealed by speeded tests. I'm just going to skip ahead here. I guess we're okay for time. I'll get to tell you a little bit more. So another, you laugh if I call this a study, but another study, yeah.
Could they be responding to the interviewer as well? Do you have native people also running the interviews?
It could be. It is something that we've thought about. Now, we've, at different times, we've had very different interviewers. So, like, a German anthropologist did a lot of these interviews. His basic stance was, I don't know anything about fish. Tell me all about it. I did a lot of interviews. My stance was, I grew up hunting and fishing. I know you know a lot. Tell me about it. These were not like one-shot interviews, so we kind of got to know these guys fairly well. The only thing I'll... This is not responsive to your question, but I'll tell you this brief story. So at one, we ran a summer research program at the College of the Menominee Nation. And one summer we had a Stockbridge Munsee woman who had grown up doing a lot of hunting and fishing. I'm sorry. I thought I had turned the sound down to nothing. She didn't look transparently native. So we had her do a bunch of interviews, in this case with hunters. And we just told her, make sure when you're interviewing a Menominee hunter that you get across the point that you're native. And when you're interviewing a European American hunter, don't. And I thought of it was like the perfect study because we vary the ethnicity of the interviewer, but we don't vary the interviewer. So interviewer style probably wouldn't affect things. Well, she got some data, but the main feedback we got was that the hunters were really upset. They didn't like her as an interviewer, and it wasn't sexism. They felt like they had been demoted because us older folks had been doing most of the interviewing and an established rapport with them. There's probably a better way of doing the study, but it is a concern. Okay, so another study we did, I'll call it a study, is we just said, tell me about the last time you went fishing. Or a particularly memorable time, favorite time fishing. And then our dependent variable was how much people talk before they got around to mentioning fish. Okay, and for the European American sample, on average, it was the 27th word. And the average is median, and the reason we use medians is fair number of our Menominee adults never got around to actually mentioning fish. They would be describing the context. You know, it's a very hot day. The dogs were kind of jumping into the river, and there were all these pests around here. And my dad got these grubs from this old decaying tree trunk, and I didn't know that he knew about that, et cetera, et cetera. So the reason I'm telling you about these data is that one, both in the children's books and in this particular measure, establishing the context is a really important thing. We've also been looking at perspective taking. I already mentioned children's books. Much more likely to invite you to take the perspective of an actor, especially an animal. Another study we did, if you're a psychologist and you want to register all your predictions these days, this is not registered. This is a study done with 4 to 5 year olds where we're explicitly asking about ecological relations. So we give them like a picture of a pine tree and a robin, and we would ask, do these go together, and if so, how? We found no differences in talking about taxonomic or morphological relationships. Large differences in ecological descriptions. Menominee children were twice as likely to nominate these kinds of relationships than their European American counterparts. The data that I found striking is that about 41% of the Menominee kids would spontaneously imitate the sound of some animal, compared to 0% of the European Americans. I find that surprising because at least when I was raising my kids, we would play these games about, you know, what does the cow say?
Yeah, but it's a farm animal.
Yeah, so exactly. Yeah, exactly. But that was a striking difference. Now, around the time we were doing this, we were using like pictures, or one of my colleagues had some plastic animals that she was going to bring up to the reservation, and one of our Menominee research assistants basically rebelled and said, you can't do this study this way. You can't just put these plastic animals. You've got no context. So she volunteered to create a forest diorama, which is kind of depicted here. And then we had four-year-olds, like 3.5 to 4-year-olds, play with the forest diorama. Study populations were young Menominee kids, young Native American kids, and young urban and suburban non-Native. So these are not Shawano County. Yeah.
Is there a difference in how much, preschools and kindergarten and schools, like in attendance of these differences between the groups?
Yes. The Native American samples are less likely to attend preschools, less likely to be able to attend them. They have, on the res, they have Head Start programs, which I guess you could think of as kind of a preschool. So, and many kids, partly because their parents work, participate in that. The 4-year-olds loved the diorama. They loved playing with it. There's probably a lot of folklore about Native kids don't talk. Native kids are just not very verbal. But at least on our forest diorama, the Native kids talk at least as much as the non-Native kids. But the result that I want to emphasize for now is we're looking to see whether or not the kids actually took an animal's perspective in play. So by that I mean if a kid picked up a deer and said, "I'm thirsty," and took it over to the pond, we're saying they took the deer's perspective. And what we found is that Native kids were something like twice as likely to take an animal's perspective.
What do you attribute to the rural versus urban Native children?
I'm sure it's not statistically reliable. So the only reliable difference is actually Menominee kids did talk more, interacted more than the other two kids, other two samples, if you look at that. I find that kind of interesting because the diorama was designed by a Menominee person. So you could say, oh, there's bias built into the design of the instrument. And I don't doubt that that's quite possible, but then you have to turn that around the other way and say, most of the time, our tasks are not designed from the perspective of the people we're studying. We really kind of blew it with our forest diorama task. We didn't have any humans in it. Maybe we implicitly don't think of humans as a part of nature. We had one deer, one bear. As I say, not even Noah made this mistake. At least two of every kind. And there are other things that we could have done. One of my Menominee friends said that we should have more seasonal information in the diorama. He was interested in how kids' play might change with the season. Okay, so now I'm going to get into some hints about more complex systems thinking. Here's one striking result. We have also done studies with expert hunters, and we asked them about different kinds of things, like does X help or hurt the forest? One of the questions was, does the porcupine help or hurt the forest? If you're European American, you say, porcupines girdle the bark of trees and the trees die. So porcupines hurt the forest. If you're about between a third and 40% of the Menominees, what you say is, oh, the porcupine helps the forest. And if you ask why, they say, well, they girdle the bark of trees, the trees die, that opens up the forest to more sunlight, that additional sunlight allows more ground cover to develop, and that facilitates moisture retention. So porcupines help the forest. So again, these are very expert hunters, and maybe it's the pragmatics of the interviewing context that Menominees maybe were more hell-bent on demonstrating their knowledge, but it's a striking difference to me. We've done studies with much younger kids, like 6 to 8 year olds, and we asked them things like, what would happen if suddenly all the bears disappeared? Or what do you think would happen if the bear population doubled? And kids are kids, so a common thing is for an answer, if you ask, what if the bear population doubled? Would be, oh, it'd be much scarier around here. But I was struck by 1 8-year-old Menominee girl who answered this question by saying, oh, there'd be more woodpeckers. And we ask her why, and she said, well, if there are more bears, I know bears will rub their backs on trees, and that will, they'll be rubbing some of the bark off, and that'll allow more insects to get into the tree, and then woodpeckers will then get the insects. So we didn't see anything like that in any of the non-native sample. My colleague at Northwestern has suggested that some ingredients for learning to reason in terms of complexity are taking multiple perspective, attending to context, and having more of a relational orientation. So in some ways, we think it's possible that native kids are better prepared for complex systems reasoning than non-native kids, and we're doing some studies to look at that. One example, I'm just going to summarize and stop. So one of the things we've done is we've looked at parents and kids interacting with the forest diorama. And if you look at the relations that European American parents are suggesting to kids, they're often very linear, like food chain responses, like A eats B, B eats C, C eats D. So they're producing food chains. With native samples, we're much more likely to see, in addition to these food chains, food webs. So it's not just A eats B, what else eats? It might be what else eats B. And if you look, if you draw out the relationships that have been mentioned, we see very large cultural differences in the input that kids are doing. We've also done studies on forest walks where we put cameras and tape recorders on adults and kids, just invite them to walk through the woods, and then we look for measures of complexity, and that would be another talk too. So I want to leave more time for discussion. Yeah, so I think I'll stop there.
So I was wondering, so presumably the Native Americans, if they understand, or is this an assumption, if they understand the complexity of nature and all the causal relationship between different parts, they might be more convinced that we should do something about climate change. So from the perspective of somebody who would like to convince people to do something, is would your advice be to teach them about the complex relationships in nature? Is there a causal relationship the other way around?
I think that's a great research question. I've been struck, at least at Northwestern, how much the total emphasis is on carbon footprint. And carbon footprint is important. I won't say it's not important, but it's kind of based on a model where humans are out, we're just here, we're trying to minimize our effect. I think there's an alternative view, which is we're part of nature, we need to be doing our part, we need to be playing our role. And there are many things we can do. You know, many of you know that there are plants that depend on humans for human interaction. I mean, the idea that an endangered species, you should keep people away from it, may not be the right model if it's one of these species where human disturbance actually facilitates the plant. So, you know, some plants, it's really disturbance that triggers their reproducing. So if you're not disturbing them. So I think that's a good question. That's one of the things we're trying to look at more and more, is how these ideas do or do not connect with the environmental decision making.
In the stories that you told about as this effect is, you had chains that were longer in the Menominee than in the European ones, where they said this eats this versus
right.
this. Is there a difference? Like, is there more of a tendency to have like long causal chains?
I'm not sure in the parent-child diorama, but for sure in the forest walk data. I might have a slide that summarizes some of this. Maybe I'm going the wrong way. In the forest walk data, there are no differences between European American and Native Americans in simple relations. A affects B. In length two, Native samples are 50% more likely to bring them up. When you get to three or more, the Native adults are something like twice as likely to mention relationships. So that's a big part of the discourse differences that we see. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Did you collect data on the religious identity of these people, of the Menominee, as well as the urban Indians and the European Americans?
We didn't do it systematically, but if you're Menominee, you're very likely to be nominally Catholic, but also have your more Native-oriented religious beliefs. And off the res, I guess, Catholic and Lutheran probably dominate Christian orientation, although there is a cult that is up in this part of Wisconsin, but we didn't sample from them. Could I ask you why you're asking the question?
Well, the European American material is so clearly coming out of the Old Testament, the Judeo-Christian tradition, and what strikes me about this information, this database, which is a fascinating field in which Google studies, is that the Native American tradition of being part of nature, as you said, though, from the beginning, is different from the Judeo-Christian tradition. And so if these people are being raised in the Catholic Church or the Lutheran Church, they're getting that background, but it's like the Native American tradition is coming out, is predominating, is even stronger. And that's very interesting.
Yeah, I don't know if they're getting that in church or not. I guess I'd have to go to church more. But what the ideas that are really widespread on the res and actually in Chicago is everything has a role to play. So when we've asked for value judgments, there's another kind of fish that's barracuda shaped that's really, really skinny. It's called a garfish. If you're European American, you just say, I have no use for them. They're just garbage. I don't know what they do. If you're a Menominee, you say, you know, I don't really know much about gar. But I know everything has a role to play. So I know they play an important role. So I think this view that, you know, and also in Chicago, we always talk about our plant and animal relatives at the American Indian Center. So we're kind of very explicitly trying to convey a relational orientation. And I think that's what fosters some of the differences. The kind of study I would like to do for complexity of reasoning is just a really simple-minded kind of study. You can be participants in this. So walleyes are often a predator fish. They eat river shiners. Northerns, as I mentioned, they're in rivers too. They eat river shiners. So what do you think would happen if all the northerns suddenly disappeared? Do you have an answer? Someone want to venture an answer? Very good. My hunch is that's going to be a Native American response. Based on Peter White's work, the dominant answer in Oxford students would be there'd be more river shiners. So in your answer, you're thinking about... Right, right, right. Yeah, there is that issue. Right. We do have some data from another indigenous group in Panama, and I would love it if we had comparable Menominee data. So with the Nobe, when we ask about interactions with humans, there we have some local non-indigenous experts. We get much more complex, broader sets of relationships, but still humans are agents and not patients. But with the Nobe, humans are pretty equally agents and patients. So that's another kind of study I'm dying to see us be able to do.
One moment.